Okay, let this load. I'll just open chat as well if I
Yeah, guys, if you want to have cameras on, please go ahead. Feel free to have it on so that Abe can also see everybody.
Perfect. Okay, hi everyone. Hi. How are you guys? So I will try to keep this towards more of knowing about how to use few softwares which are good for a UI UX designer, and then we will go about a little bit of more about into Q&A, because I know a lot of people want to ask specific problems, and that's the best way to go about a workshop. But before starting, I would like to give a little introduction about myself. So who am I? I am Abhay Chopra. So I am a UI UX designer from around last 2 years, but I've been into design industry from last 6 to 7 years. I have been at I have been a TEDx speaker. I have worked with a lot of organizations, from startup to MNCs, from freelance to a lot of different fields. But today we are going to talk about how to design a user experience so that it conveys the user, it kind of fulfills the user's needs, and the overall process of going through a particular app or any e-commerce or anything seems very good. Okay, so before starting, I just wanted to ask you guys about if you guys can just vote in the chat, like, who are you? Like, do you know Figma? Because Figma is a particular software which we are going to use. If you don't, then I will start from scratch and try to let you know what Figma is, what other tools you guys can use, a little bit about that. If you guys know Figma, then I would just like to dive into how to design few things. If you guys can just vote about one or two in the chat. I think the chat is open, right, guys? Should be. Okay, perfect. Okay, I don't know Figma. No Figma. Okay, so most of you guys don't know Figma. Have over heard of Figma. Got it. Perfect. Okay, so almost all of you don't know Figma. So let me just go through before starting, like, what really we need to start this whole thing, that is UI UX, right? So this is Figma. The presentation is on Figma. If I just zoom out, you will be able to see the app or the website that we're going to make and everything. But yeah, so this is Figma. So let me just go around and kind of just slide it up, and let's just see what is it in Figma. When you open Figma, you will be able to go to home page. There are a lot of designs which I made, but yeah, you will be able to see a lot of page designs. You guys will be able to make your own design by clicking this plus icon, right? When you click this plus icon, there's a two options. There's a FigJam file, there's a design file. Currently, you should just know about making a design file. FigJam is very recent in Figma. This is basically like a whiteboard. Like, for example, you and a lot of other people are working on a single project, and you want to kind of brainstorm on different things. And this is just like an area for that. But we will go into design files. Once I click design file, a design file is created. So let's just go with the different tools. I will try to keep it short because there are thousands of tutorials on YouTube to know what Figma is and how to use Figma. So I will just try to skim it really fast so that you would know what is it and how to use it. Other softwares, I would also like to mention other software. There are softwares like Adobe XD, Sketch. They are two primary other options which you guys can use. Figma is best because it's free for a good amount of time for an individual at least. If you are want to collaborate, or if you have a team, then I think your employer will have a subscription for Figma which you guys can use. So once you go into Figma, there are this is these are the tools. So whenever you design something, you kind of create an artboard. So giving you a practical example, if you kind of want to paint something, if you want to sketch something, you have artboard, you have a canvas, right, where you paint or sketch. So artboard here is also something. How to create an artboard? You can click A on your keyboard, or you can just go over here and click this icon. Okay, frame. You got the artboard. Now see over here, you got a lot of options like phone, tablet, desktop, presentation, watch, paper, social media, and a lot of others, right? So if I go into Figma, for it, let's just say if I want to create an app for iPhone X, I just click on it, I have a artboard. What is an artboard? Now you see. So the artboard is basically a frame in which I can design the whole app, right? And that's what an artboard is all about. Now, this was the what about artboard. Now, for example, if I want to create a shape over here, right? So Now see over here, there are rectangle, line, arrow, ellipse, polygon, star, or if you want to place an image, that's a different thing. But yeah, so this is a rectangle. I can click, I can shape anything, right? So I can click over here. Okay, I just made this thing. Now if I want to change the dimension, on the right side you see there's a design palette, design, you can say option. You see W is the width. If I increase it, it increases the width. And H is the height. I can decrease the height or increase the height. It depends on me, right? How I want to go forward with that. And X and Y, you don't have to look around that. It's basically where your particular element should be in the whole canvas. But this is, instead of this, I just grab it and take wherever I want. But yeah. So the other things is that you can see the fill color, okay? So I can click on fill. I can choose any color that I want, right? Red, blue, whatever the F I want, right? I can choose gradients as well. Let's just say I choose linear. You see, there's a gradient, like it's going from purple to this. Let's just know I want to go to purple from to red. Okay, but you see here, once I click red, the opacity is zero. This is the opacity. I just click 100, the opacity is 100, and this is going like this. Now let's just say if I want less of purple, I will just grab it, hold the key, and grab it up. It's like a little more fluent. This is how we can create gradients, right? Now there are more type of gradient: radial, angular, diamond, and you can place an image if you want as well. This is a random image. We can choose if we want to as well. Right now I'm not going to choose. Similarly, you can go with any type of element as well, right? Now if let's just change it to solid and a single color, okay? Now let's just assume I want to curve the radius. Like I want to have a curve rectangle, right? I click it, this icon. It's written corner radius. Whatever digit I increase, it basically curves it. If I go on, yeah, you might be able to see it curves. If I decrease it to zero, it's like sharp. If I increase it more, it's like more curved. So this is how I can kind of have a curve like it. Now, let's just assume, now see, this is an artboard. This is a rectangle which is outside an artboard. Now let's just shorten it up and you see the indentation. This is the artboard. Inside the artboard is a rectangle. Now I can add more things inside as well. Let's just assume I want to add a text. I click on T for having a text. I click on here and whatever I write. It's inside the artboard, you see. Now if I want it outside the artboard, just click it, grab it, and it's outside the artboard. Just wanted to know, because when we design it, you will get to know how it's going to be. Now see, it's outside the artboard, but the artboard is just this frame. So I need to get it here to see inside the artboard. So this was a little brief. I don't want to go into the prototype section right now, because if I go, it will be really confusing. But you just assume, once we have made the whole design, like it's a 2-3 screens, I want to be like, if I click a single button, it goes to a different screen, and that's how it goes. That is basically prototyping. If I want to do it, I can go do it over here as well. Inspect is something for developers. Let's just see, I am a front-end developer as well, assuming, which I'm not, just to be very frank. So I'm a front-end developer. I designed a website. Now I want a lot of elements pre-rolled, a lot of elements which are already there, which I can copy-paste. Now you go into inspect, you will be able to see all the position, width, background, and a lot of other things. If I click a specific thing, I can think about that. I can see the color code and a lot of other things. If I want to, I can see the typography, the weight, blah, 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 and every information which is useful for a developer to be used in creating that particular app or website, right? So this was a little brief about what Figma is and what are the little functions in Figma. Now let's just go into our presentation. Okay, so you guys voted. So I just want to go brief about how this workshop or the talk is going to go. I told you about Figma. Now we are going to go and see how a website is being designed. I want to go with two options. One is a portfolio, which I have kind of taken from somewhere from online. And one is a landing page. I will tell you what a landing page as well when we go into that. And third one is a mobile view. Basically, whatever website we make, we need to have a mobile view as well. So I will tell you about that. And at the end, we will go into Q&A. And just for a bonus, I will also show you an app that I designed 2 days back. So yeah, let's just go into this. That is a website. So this is what we're going to do. Okay, you see, this is a website. So let's just remove the grid. I will tell you what the grid, what are grids as well. Layout. Okay, so see. So what is it? This is a website. You see on the left, there's a typography section. There's a color palette section. You can ignore this. These are just images. I can just remove them as well for now. Now, if I go on, you see, what are typography? Whenever you design a particular website or an app, you need to have a style guide. Okay. These two things included, that is colors and typography, are style guide. What is typography? Typography is basically what kind of text we are going to use. The size, the fonts, what is it? Face, that is regular, bold, super bold, extra bold, whatever it is, light or whatever. Now see, over here I have written, let's just say the highest size will be label 1, 117 regular size. Okay, the font is Sen. Sen is the font name over here. You can see the font name. I can change the font as well if I want to. I can do whatever I want, right? But for now, we will keep it Sen. Okay. Now you see heading 1, heading 2. I have taken down a little note over here how this will look, and also the size and the space as well. In the other section, you might be able to see the colors. Colors are very, very important when we're trying to design anything, right? And there are different type of colors. That is base color, primary colors, accent colors, and a lot of other things. We need to ideate on how these colors are made. Not gonna go into how colors are made. I will definitely let you know the tools which you guys can use to choose which kind of colors you wanna have, right? But this is basically the colors section where we use base, level 1, light gray. We can choose whatever we want. Accent is basically a color which we choose to kind of highlight a particular action that we want the user to perform, right? Now see over here, if we go into the website, so see, when this is the first frame, this is the first fold, we call it in our language. This whole section that is still here, okay, this is the whole section, is the hero section. Hero section is the section which basically attracts or gives the major information about the whole website, and that is very, very, very important, right? Now see, when we go into this particular section, if you want to, like if I said how to design an artboard, as I said, click A, I can go into a desktop, MacBook, and I have a artboard. I can increase it to have the same thing, right? This is how we can go about it. Okay. So once we have the artboard, if you want to, let's just say create this whole thing, this particular thing. I have the image wherever I can get it from. Let's just assume first we need to change the background color. Color picker, this is a color picker tool. This can pick any color from anywhere. I just pick the color. I need to have one more rectangle. For rectangle, I click R or just click over here. I just take a rectangle. I will try to make it very rough for you guys for right now. I will click the colors from over here. These colors are already decided over here. You see, this was a level 1 color. This was the base color. This was the accent color, you see. This was the primary color. So you guys can see how colors are already been decided and used in the whole design. If I click it over here, you guys can see there are, this is the text that I want to create. Let's just see, I want to create a text. I am someone, okay? I increase the size to 96. Okay, I am someone. Okay, someone new. This is good. This, I accepted this. These are the alignment. I can click it center align, left align, right align. I want to make it left align. This is all good. I just keep it over here, right? Now what is left? Image is left. For image, for right now, I will just copy it from over here, but I can do one more thing. I created a rectangle for the image that I wanted. I want an image over here, right? And I want it into back. That is, I can right click, I can get it into backwards. That is, I want the text first. Now I selected the rectangle. Now see, there are a lot of plugins that we can use on Figma. To add the plugin, you just go over to this particular icon, plugin, and you manage plugin, and you will be able to, these are the installed plugins, you will be able to see in the community to kind of add more plugins over here, right? I have added a lot of plugins. So one more option to do that as well, go into plugins, manage plugins, and browse plugins in this. Oh, I can browse over here and I can see any plugin that I want. For now, I will add the I have the Unsplash one. I will just use it. What is Unsplash? Unsplash is a basically website where I can get a lot of free images, open source, which I can use in my design. Because a lot of time when we design, we don't have a lot of images of our own use to use it. So we can use Unsplash. Basically, once I click Unsplash, I can just click any image that I want to use. Like I just assume I click this. I have this image in the rectangle. I can decrease it, increase it in whichever direction I want. I like this one. Increase it. Perfect. I have someone. I'm okay with it. You see, this is how I can design. Similarly, you can create everything over here. I had this image before. I had this. And I will give you every resources that you can use to make these things as well. So once we go into this, so basically why this hero section is just like this. I will give you an example of a landing page, because landing pages are the pages which are basically made by marketing agencies for a campaign. What does a landing page do? Is basically when we have a landing page, whenever someone gets on a landing page, the whole purpose of the landing page is to grab a user to convert it into a customer. For example, I will give you an example for one landing page that I have, but a very realistic example right now is that when we go into a landing page, when we go into a specific ad for a course, when we click on it, we go into a landing page where we can see a lot of specific information about the workshop, that is bonuses, content, who is giving the workshop, their social proofs and everything. And the CTA, that is the call to action, what the particular agency wants you to do that in that landing page is to buy that course, right? So that's the particular CTA. And every time a CTA is mentioned, it is always recommended to have it in an action pillar, because that is something that specifies or grabs the attention of the user. So for example, if I go into this particular website, what's the CTA? Contact. That is the CTA. The person wants everyone who comes to the website to contact him for anything, like for having a gig, for anything. I don't know, whatever the person wants. Now, what the website is all about is mentioned in the hero section. Let's just say he mentioned that he is this, he's a product designer based in Italy, and a little bit about himself, right? Then as we go, this is a particular portfolio website. Then he told about which companies he worked on, a little his about himself, moreover to what he really is in terms of design. Then skill sets, companies he has worked with, projects. Once I click on the project, I can get onto another page to see the project information. Instagram, his dribble, his things people say about him, right? And then he has his photography. Then this is the contact. Whenever we click contact, we get over here and we can see. See, this is how he has kind of created the whole website. And you see, the whole website is being kind of created for the mobile section as well. So see how this whole thing is mentioned over here. He has kind of mentioned it over like this. When we click this, all these icons will be seen in a little other aspect. But yeah, that's something that is going to happen. Then he has mentioned the same things over here. Companies has worked for. So this is how you can kind of just make the design responsive. And making the design responsive means it is both validated on a mobile as well as a desktop. And that's very, very important nowadays, because 90% of the audience will see your website on a mobile. And that's why you need to have a mobile website first as well. Giving more example on the website front is that this is how a website is being made. Same thing, you see a design guide or a style guide. This is a background, this is something else which you kind of just use in the whole design. This is a wireframe. What is a wireframe? Wireframe is a step that we go forward first to give a structure of the website, like how the website should look like, just like blocks, not specific section, right? And the whole, this section that is mentioned, this is the hero section, as I told. Now, this is a particular landing page. And what would be the purpose? Because see, smart banking for fresh freelancers. So what's the purpose? To register users for their app, right? That's the whole purpose of this particular landing page. So this is how this landing page is being made. So see the logo, there's a menu icons, the CTA, another CTA over here, a little animation, or not animation, illustration, then little features about it, then their plans, free one, premium one, right? Then frequently asked questions are very, very important in a landing page, because in a landing page, you are able to see, because a lot of people have a lot of confusion before buying. They want to get it cleared on the landing page itself. And that's why we kind of focus on the frequently asked questions on a landing page, not on every website. E-commerce has a different aspect of designing, but yeah, this is how this goes. Then this is basically the footer, right? So that's how a landing page happens. Now, at the end, I would like to go for an app. An app is very, very important, right? This is a money app, right? This basically kind of balances out all your expenses and everything in the go, right? Yes, sir. It's kind of same as Marvel, but Marvel is more over to sketching part, not specific designs that we use in terms of like these things. We can't use a lot of illustrations. It's like more, it's just like I use Marvel, but when I'm trying to test the wireframes that I've made, the whole process is good or not, if anybody is talking at some place or not, something like that. That's how Marvel works. And Marvel is really great and really works in this industry as well.
What about Adobe XD?
Adobe XD is just like Figma. If you know another single software, so the whole process stays the same. Just the software changes. And even in the software, 90% of the things remains the same. It might be possible that the prototype section is not over here, it's over here, or the layers are over here. That's the only difference in softwares like Photoshop. Sorry, not Photoshop, but Adobe XD, Sketch, and Figma. These three softwares. Yeah.
And how do you pick the colors when you're designing something? How do you actually choose?
That's something very great. So let me just show the tool right now itself. So when I go over here, so I have these things already made. So this is a website called colors.co with a double O. C-double-O. I can just paste it over in the chat. Yeah. So this is a website. So they already automate your color palette. So if I click start generator, they will generate color palettes for me. If I don't like it, I just click generate once more. It just generate one more. Whatever I like, I eventually choose.
That's amazing. I didn't know about it. That's very nice.
Yeah. So this is the color palette for a lot of colors. When you are trying to use few colors in a particular thing, not just in app or website design, but in any design. But this is a kind of resource. This is not exactly color palette, but there are a lot of color combinations over here. Like just two color combinations. A lot of time we don't want to use a lot of colors in a, let's just say I design a just single screen or single landing page, but I don't want a lot of colors. So I can choose this one. Why I like this one is I don't have to choose a lot of, I think there are more than 100 combinations. Yeah. So I can choose any combination and it has already been validated by the users. But to choose these, there's a code of this particular color only, not the background color. So to choose a background color, use a plugin called ColorZilla. This can be added on in Firefox, Chrome, I think Edge as well. I don't know, but yeah, Safari as well. So if you choose this particular icon, whenever you install this extension, you just click on a particular color, you will be able to grab the particular color code and you will be able to paste it anywhere that you want. So that's one more option as well. I will write the name for ColorZilla. Yeah, that's the extension. So there are a lot of resources already available to choose the colors, but a lot of time we also need to choose it over ourselves. So the best thing is to use a color wheel. If you guys know what it is. So this is actually a color wheel, okay? Actually a color wheel. These are not specific color wheels. If you go into a more, this is actually a color wheel, okay? So when you design this now, so a lot of time when you need to design, my highly suggested, if you want to use just two colors, use the colors which are on the opposite side. Let's just assume we use this particular color. The other color, if you want to use with this color, is the opposite side of this, right? They are the good best combination right now. And that's how we can use these colors as well. There are a lot of colors like primary, contemporary, secondary, and different, but that's very deep inside knowledge. I think this is a good resource to tell you about it. No, I think this is wrong. But yeah, this is basically explaining like primary color, secondary color, tertiary color, warm color, cool colors. But the best I can give you advice is, if you don't want to think anything, if you don't want to learn this, just choose colors which are on the opposite side. They will combine very, very well. That's the best advice I can give for the colors at least. Yeah, one more option if you want to take it as, if you know Pinterest. Pinterest has a lot of already made photos or natural, let's just say, colors, right? So just use ColorZilla, pick the colors from a particular picture, two colors which are combining very well, and use that. That's making your own color palette from the nature. That's the one more advice I can give. Yeah, for the app. So this particular app is a app which is trying to track everyone's expenses. So whenever you open an app, what happens? You see a login screen, you see an onboarding process, right? So for the onboarding process, this is how it happens. Whenever you open an app, you see this. You see this where it's illustrations, you see save your money, it tells about a little bit about the app. When you click next, it goes to next. When you click get started, it basically opens up your sign up page. You click sign in, you write your username or password, right? And one more thing that I really want to talk about over is, you might see that there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 screens of sign up and sign in, even though the whole process, it's the same, right? But I really want to talk about why we have a lot of screens over here. So when you are designing a user experience, the main thing is trying to cover all the use cases as much as possible, right? So how you can do that? So covering use cases means, for example, if I click sign in, right? Once I go into sign in, what if I write the wrong address? So it shows like this, that you have the email address is incomplete or something like that. What if I want to see the password? So if I want to see the password, I can just click this. And if I don't want to see this, I just cover this case. What if I click on a particular password or email to write it? How the keyboard comes up? The keyboard comes up like this. So I tried to cover all the use cases as much as possible. Why? Because this is how the user experience is designed. This is all we cover in a user experience, that every step the user is helped by us. The user gets to know that we are here to help them provide whatever they need. What if I want to know, let's just say OTP. What if I added OTP, but how do I know that the verified button is not clickable? I kind of dim down the opacity to make it look like that. So this shows that the button is disabled, right? We all are embedded with these things in every app. You see, every app, basic functions will be same. Whenever the button is disabled, either it will be gray or either it will be a little lighter color, right? So that basically gives you an intention that the button is disabled. And when the button is enabled, either it will be a darker color or either it will be highlighted, just like this, right? So this is how you can kind of create a user experience which helps you know that you are kind of fulfilling users' needs, right? So this particular app is how you can go about it. So you see how I covered all the use cases. You see, over here, we kind of covered the use case of when it's fully filled, when it's not filled. Over here, I will go into more specific. For example, when it's filled, it's basically highlighted with a little purplish bottom line. If it's not filled, it's like gray. So every case, every single point is important for a user experience to take forward, right? And when we go forward, let's just see this over here. If you haven't filled anything, why would I want you to click on complete? So it's like grayish in color. If you haven't have completed it, I can click on complete and go forward with it. This is how the whole process, this is how the whole setup looks. This is not a live app, just to know. This is a hypothetical concept, but yeah. So this is basically how, when I click this particular button, this is how it comes out. Over here, I can see the cards in a single form, just like how I wanted to represent. And I try to cover every use case as much as possible, but it's a concept, so it is designed few screens. Just wanted to know, covering all the use cases is very important, specifically in an app. Why? Because app is something that has a lot of screens. Website might not have, because website is a single page, and even if it has a lot of pages, it's just specific pages, right? So that's how it usually goes. I think this one is prototype. I will just see. Yeah, this one is prototype. Let me show you a little bit prototype how that works as well. So let's just go into prototype play. So what I did, I just got into prototype. So this particular app is prototyped. You see these arrows, this means this is prototype. I have already animated this. I just click on the play button to play the prototypes. Now see, so my mouse is a little off. So if I hope it works. Will it? Nope. Yeah, it does. So when I go over here, you see, so I have already prototyped few sections. So you see over here, if I click over here, I can see this prototype set. You see, this is an animation that is being created over here itself, nowhere else, right? See, so Figma can also be used to prototype or do a little micro interactions, we call these things, right? And if I click, if I hover over this button, it is basically done like this. If I click over here, and if I go down into this, if I click over to, I don't think this is over here. Let me just see which particular page. Yeah. So if I click over to play again and go into the first screen and go down, and if I click this particular button, you see the answer to this. So this is also a random answer, but once I click over this, you see the button is changed to from positive to negative. That negative means closing, positive means opening, and this is how the whole things happen. See, this is how, this is so cool, na? You can basically animate a lot of things over here. I just animated a little. These are micro interactions. You can animate full app, right? A lot of people do. A lot of, not just people, a lot of industry does that part as well. So this is very, very important when we're trying to do something. Just before we get into the Q&A, I just want to get into that. I wanted to let you guys know a little bit about these things, like how these are made. For the illustrations, just for a reference, for the illustrations, these are not exactly designed in Figma. You can get in Figma, but not exactly designed in Figma, right? But let me tell you how you can get a lot of things in Figma for free. You see, once you get into homepage, you see this button. Mostly you will have this. Once I click over here, you can go into the community page. A lot, not just you, but a lot of other people have created a lot of things which you can get from over here. Giving an example, let's just assume I want illustrations. I click on illustrations. You see, a lot of illustrations are already made in the Figma file. Let's just assume I want this particular 3D illustration, right? I click over here. I love this illustration. I click duplicate. It opens up. I have the illustration with me in Figma itself. So that's how Figma community is so awesome that it already has a lot of illustrations pre-rolled in this whole thing, right? So like, let's just say I want this particular icon over this particular page, okay? Not this one, I don't want this, I want this icon. I copied it, I just got over here, I just click C, that is copy, and then I just pasted it over here. I have my illustration over here. See how this is so cool. You guys can use a lot of resources which are already available online to make it into something very unique. I think that's all that I wanted to cover. Anything? Nope, I think that's all. Yep. Now over to you guys. If you guys want to ask anything specific that you want me to go forward with or want to ask, you guys can. Yeah.
If everybody wants to put their questions in the chat, or maybe they can unmute themselves and go ahead. I just have one question: that how do you make sure that the user experience is seamless? It doesn't have too many steps, and it doesn't have too less steps as well. Like, how do you know what is the optimum number of user experience steps and screens?
It totally depends on an app to app. But what I would say, usually what happens in an industry level is that whenever you join a company or a startup or anywhere, you get a PRD, that is project requirement document, right? In that, you will get everything that they need, right? Now, for example, if I am designing a web, so what if I'm designing a portfolio? What I want for a person to know about me? So once they go into a website, I want to know who am I. I will go into that. I want them to have a button where they can kind of look over to my works. I want to have a button, let's just assume for me, I usually have a button of speaks, whatever, wherever I have spoken, writings, whatever I have written, contact me and stuff like this, right? So these are the buttons. These are the steps. Actually, these are the steps which I want the user to take. But this is a website for me. So I can decide which amount of steps I want and which amount of steps I don't want, right? But when you are trying to go into a website like Amazon or not Google, Google is very simple, but Amazon, Flipkart, Zomato, something like that. So what happens is when you go into Swiggy, there are a lot of features. Like there are features like you can buy a super coupon something. There you can buy a subscription. You can buy a healthy. You can buy a you can have a genie thing. You can have to. So we need to take care of a lot of things. Usually, how this happens is you create a user flow. What is a user flow? User flow is basically you start from scratch. Whenever someone enters, you cater for a person who has nothing, right? And you start designing wherever they can go from it. And every use case, try to cover every use case as much as possible. 99% of the time, you will miss a lot of use cases. Why? Because we are not the user, right? Never assume that you are the user. You can kind of design the process, but a lot of time you will miss the things. So how that happens? When you design it, you do a wireframe about that. As you said, Marvel or whatever you use, you do a wireframe about that. And then you test out with a good amount of, that is called preliminary evaluation. You test out with the users. You test them out. You understand what, wherever the user got blocked, wherever the user faced some issue. Was the button too small? Was the button too big? Should I add this step? Should I remove this step? You get a lot of insight from that particular preliminary evaluation. After that feedback, you can decide if you want to remove the steps, add the steps, or whatever you want to do. So that's the best. Testing is the best phase to test out, but user flow is the first step to analyze how many amount of steps are needed in that particular app. That's one thing. Okay, I think we can go three-click rule. Yeah, three-click rule works, but it depends. Like a lot of time you won't be able to do something in three clicks. Like for example, checkout. You cannot do it in three clicks. If I see a product, I click buy now or add to cart. Anything can happen. Let's assume I click buy now. After buy now, I need to check out my address, a delivery address. Then I need to choose the payment option. Then I need to fill the payment option. Then I need to confirm the delivery or whatever payment is done, right? 5 steps. So it cannot be done. And also I don't think we can minimize it any way possible. So that's how it happens. Can we animate the illustrations on Figma? We can. Definitely we can. Let me just show you one thing. I think you guys will know this icon. How do we design this? Oh, for example, let's just assume I want to have a moon over here. Okay. So I have an ellipse. I can just click O or just go over an ellipse. I designed one circle and I just copy and paste it. Even if you can click Alt. I have two circles overlapping each other. I will just change another. You can say this gray part is a moon, right? Directly or indirectly. I just click both of them. These are the masking options. I can mask, but this is a mask that I did wrong because I did it like this. I don't want to mask. I want to subtract this. You see, there are a lot of union, subtract, intersect, whatever I want to do. Basically, I want to subtract it. When I subtract it, basically the upper circle has been subtracted from the lower circle. So the moon remains. Now I want to fill the color. I want to do it with gradient. I will try to do it with white and then I will give it a little grayish color, 100 opacity, sorry. And then you can go about this. This is how a moon is made. You can add a lot of things. You can make a lot of things which I have in mind. I usually make a lot of icons over here. I think, yep. Oh, if you see, this bell icon is made in Figma. This icon is made in Figma. These icons are made in Figma. So it's very easy to make. These are icons, but you can make illustrations as well. Nowadays, a lot of people are making illustrations and posting it on LinkedIn. So yeah, it can be done. It's possible. But I suggest don't waste your time on illustrations unless you are good at graphic design. Then instead of Figma, use Illustrator. That's an easy part. Yeah. Then in UX career, really, is UX career really worth compared to engineering and other STEM fields? Let me tell you one thing. I will give you an example with a particular fact. Glass. If you guys know Glassdoor, Glassdoor is a service where you can see salaries of a lot of people. Just show. Yep. UX designer. UX designer. Assume location in India. Okay. A UX designer salary in Republic of whatever it's written, average base salary is 14 lakh per annum. I don't think anyone can get this much in this field. Why? Let me tell you why. Why UX designer basically earns this much is because of the fact it's a growing field. not a lot of UX designers are out there, and not a lot of people who are experienced or who know how to do stuff. That's why the pay is too high. Let's assume a software engineer in India. Also, so I have to say search. It's 7 lakh. You see, double. I have to log in, but you see the salary is 7 lakh, right? It's double. Now you tell me which is what, software engineering or UI design. This is a basic path. That's what I want.
Depend on the area. I mean,
exactly. If you go into US, I can tell you in UX as well. So in US as well. So my brother lives in US. So he usually tells me about, he works at Twitter. So I am a UX designer. If I kind of get at Twitter as a junior UI UX designer, I will get more paid than any junior software or Android developer at there. That's the salary base. And a lot of times when you are a designer, you get a lot of freelance gigs as well. So like currently I'm working at 2 startups as a intern, but I'm also doing around 4 to 5 freelance gigs every month. So it's way too easy for a designer to get freelance gigs if you have a good personal mind. A lot of factors come in, but yeah, it's certainly easy for a lot of people to go around it. Anybody else, have any questions before we go, I will just like to drop a form just for a feedback from my side. I usually take a lot of feedback from people, how the talk went and everything. Kind of dropping the form, just fill it up, and I will also give you the Figma file for this one. I will just mail you guys because nowadays I can share it with link, but you will not be able to see it. There's a limit of 4 or 5 persons. Figma has very much strict out on their platform, so there is a limitation of how we can go forward with it sharing. But I can download the file and I can give you guys on the email, which you can use later on, so you guys can go forward with it. And just for another sake, if you guys want to know, so I have a little community of designers. We are around 500 designers. I think I can show you the pic as well. Yeah. So this opens up. I hope it does. I have a little community which we have started, and we recently kind of grabbed on to Discord. We usually were working on Telegram and every place else. We usually just grabbed on to, I can go into Luma. No, I have to go into Design Hat eventually. Yep, if this opens up. Then basically, so we are a community, small community of people who kind of help budding designers to grow in design industry. So we do weekly podcasts and everything. If you guys want to join in as well, I'm dropping the Discord link. It's not even launched. The Discord is not even launched. It will be launched, I think, within the next few days. So this is it. If you guys, we do a lot of podcasts from our experienced people. Like Jyotsna over here has a 12 years experience. Tanaya kind of transitioned from graphic design to UI UX. And a lot of people they are all a part of community and will help you guys and grow in whichever way possible. We are always there as well. So if you guys have any other questions, I'm always up for it. If you want to ever follow me, if you want to follow me on social media, I'm available on every social media. Just write the Abhay Chopra. That's my tag everywhere. That's the easy part. Just a little quick fun fact. A lot of people ask me why the Abhay Chopra. I usually don't talk about it until someone asks, but I do. Why? Because you see, when you have a brand name, right, a user can remember, right? For example, right now, if I want to find anything on internet, if I have any question, what do I say? You can Google it, right? I don't see you search it at Bing, you search it at somewhere else. So Google has branded themselves as in whenever someone has any question in their mind, which a lot of people have every second. So you just say Google it. That's the value of brand, right? And that's how usually you should also make your own value as well. So that's why the Abhay Chopra. So even if I Google the Abhay Chopra, if I Google Abhay Chopra right now, I will get 0 responses or very limited responses from my side. But if I write the Abhay Chopra, each and every link from till page 3 are all mine. So that's the power of SEO and brand. So that's something. Yep, I think should be that's it from my side.
That's an amazing tip, by the way. Okay, thank you so much for your talk. All of the things which you said, they really made sense. And there were so many things which even I was like unfamiliar about. And I think everybody in the room really took something away. Even if it was in the UX, it was definitely they took something away. So we have one last question. What are the most critical changes that we must make to face the future effectively in the design industry?
There are a few technologies which you should learn, which I am also learning. I know the coding part of it, but not the design. But I really want you to know about it. So there is one thing that is really going. If you are into crypto, so see, a lot. I won't go really specific, but I want to give my thoughts about it. So see, NFT. NFT is a space where a lot of UI UX designers has not kind of grabbed the opportunity over that space. But I don't want to say about it because a lot of people think crypto is not good, blah blah. So I don't want to force that, but I really want to say NFT is a space where UI UX will definitely blow. For example, if I design a user flow or a user experience which is so good that nobody can ever beat that user experience, and I sell it as an NFT, so it's going to boom. It's going to definitely sell. A lot of ideas can come around that. First is NFT. But for the things that you want to, changes that you want to have, is that try to learn every day. So currently, even I have a good amount of experience. I learn each and every day from everywhere, wherever as possible. For example, AR, VR designing is specifically something that's going to blow up. And then I think voice first design. So basically, I also have the poll on LinkedIn a few days back where I think 200-350 people kind of responded, where I asked, do you think voice first design will boom in the coming few years? Out of 350 people, 300 people said yes. There will be something, right? So that's the power of voice. Even right now, I think my whole room and everything is settled with automation. And I just say, go to Google, yeah, do something, he or she will do it, right? So you need to kind of work on the voice command system, like how you can do that. It can happen on Figma as well. It's very complex, but it does happen. And I think things are getting developed in that version as well. So if you can grab that opportunity right now, it's the best time. AR, VR is something that's going to go. And for example, if you see about the UI, we usually go around app, website, that's all. We don't go beyond that. There's a watch. There's a car UI. There are a lot of things which don't even go. You see, like if you are from India, there's a brand named Mahindra or any, that is a Toyota or any brand. Can you even imagine Toyota is hiring UI UX designer? Why? Because they want to have a app design which is unique, because these are very, very important features nowadays right now. So this is something that you have to keep in mind and try to update yourself in the design industry. News, Twitter is a good handle about it. Follow people on social media, let's just say YouTube, Twitter. These are good fields to explore design trends and things like that. But yeah, you have to kind of mix technology with design to kind of have a good impact.
Okay, I think Nikhil is here, but thank you, Abhay. Thank you so much for your talk. It was amazing, and I feel everybody learned something new today. Everybody, please look up Abhay on LinkedIn and definitely follow him there. I just did right now. So you would definitely have some updates from him, and you can connect with him later. And thank you so much, Abhay.
Thank you so much, guys, for having me. Thank you so much. Bye, guys. Take care.
Hi. All right. I think we have Nikhil here now.
Yes.
Hi, Nikhil. Nikhil is giving a web development workshop. And it's pretty linked up, because now we just had a UX workshop by Abhay, and now we have Nikhil giving a web development workshop. So we're very excited for that. So if you would like, you can start now and I'll just stop recording and start again.